All right, I'd like to introduce Mr. Congressman Gerald Golden. He grew up in Leeds, a small rural town in Maine's 2nd Congressional District. After September 11th attacks, Mr. Marine Corps. He served 4 years in the military as an infantryman, deploying to Afghanistan in 2004 and Iraq in 2005 to 2006. When Mr. Golden returned from service, he used the benefits he'd earned in the military to attend Lewiston's Bates College. While in school, he returned to Afghanistan as a volunteer school teacher. In 2011, Mr. Golden began serving as a staff member on the U.S. Senate Homeland Security and Governmental Affairs Committee for Senator Susan Collins. In 2014, Mr. Golden was elected to represent Lewiston in the Maine House of Representatives. He has passed legislation to help homeless veterans get back on their feet, fought for union workers' rights and access to workers' compensation benefits, and advocated for passenger rail services in Maine to help grow and strengthen local economies. In the Maine State Legislature, Golden was chosen by his peers to serve as the Democratic Assistant Majority Leader in 2016. In 2018, he was elected to serve the people of Maine's 2nd District. He currently lives in Lewiston with his wife, Isabel. Also on the panel today, we have Cynthia Finney. Cindy is the president of the Maine AFL-CIO, a federation of approximately 160 labor unions, representing approximately 40,000 workers across the state. She is also currently the president of the Maine Fair Trade Campaign, a coalition of labor, environmental, social justice, and faith organizations working together for the creation of socially, economically, and environmentally just and sustainable trade policies and a fair global economy. Also on your panel today, we have Ms. Christine Greenleaf, an employee of the Maine AFL-CIO as bookkeeper office manager. She started that in January of this year. But previously, she worked under a contract with the Maine Department of Labor, providing rapid response services to workers from companies laying off or closing, including explaining the trade program to workers and encouraging them to become certified under the program. Chris has been with the Maine AFL-CIO for 20 years. My name is Mike Castaneda. I'm a former Wausau paper mill worker. I worked in the paper industry for 20 years, lost my job, and then through Trade Act benefits myself, we got Trade Act benefits for all the workers out of the Wausau paper mill, and through that, allowed me to become reemployed myself. So we kind of been there and done that, and we're here today to discuss NAFTA's new proposals, and if anybody has any questions, the panel will be glad to try to answer them.
All right.
Take it away.
I'm just going to stand up for the introduction piece and during the panel, we'll all sit. But you know, if you can't hear us, let us know and we can speak up. I appreciate you all coming out and having a bit of a conversation tonight about what has been described as the USMCA. This would be the new trade deal that the administration has worked on as a potential replacement to NAFTA. What some people call it NAFTA 2.0, the terminology that I tend to use. I think real briefly I'll describe a conversation that I had with some of the different national unions that are out there and are looking at this, all of whom have not really taken an official position on this yet. I think that they approach it with a healthy level of skepticism and have asked to see more put in there that would give them some assurances that it might accomplish what people will say that it will. But someone, I asked them to compare this new trade deal to NAFTA and then compare it also to no NAFTA. And what they basically said was if this right here were like the line, yeah, this is kind of, I think Dante here, I'd never read it, but anyway. You know, they said if this right here were hell, then we would put NAFTA somewhere down here. And we would put this USMCA trade proposal to replace NAFTA just about a shade higher than NAFTA. And no NAFTA might be somewhere up around here. That was just their personal perspective. But I think it gives you a sense of where some of the unions out there are on the issue, and it could get better. Certainly, they think that improvements to NAFTA is a good thing, but I think there's always a fear that when you do something, you want to get it right, and try and get it right the first time, because you get locked into something like this, you're locked in for quite a while, and it can have a big impact on people's lives, as many of you know better than I when talking about NAFTA and what it has, what was promised and what it's delivered, and what the impact has been in the United States and in states like Maine, which we're going to talk a little bit about tonight. Where we are in the process is the president has signed this deal. We're still in NAFTA. He signed this new agreement with Mexico and Canada. Now it has to be agreed upon by Congress. They are currently, things got slowed down the process a little bit by that 35, 6, I can't remember how many days, shutdown that started back in December after the election, but before I got seated. So it slowed things down a very little bit, but in the next, let's say, month or so, we should see coming out of the administration a proposed implementation legislation, which would lay out the number of law changes which the United States would have to make in order to enter into this trade deal with Mexico and Canada, uphold our end of the bargain. Some of you, if you follow closely the debate a couple of years ago around TPP, may remember discussions about fast-tracking of trade deals, whereby you just bring these trade deals up for a vote, up or down, with no amendment process whatsoever. That is certainly a potential option that we could see chosen in Congress. It's one that I think the people of America were broadly against, the idea that Congress's hands would be tied and just have to vote up or down on something rather than try and be a part of the process to improve it. Another option, of course, is that we make some changes to the implementation bill, but that doesn't touch the actual trade agreement itself. And finally, you know, there's always the option that the president, the administration, and Congress could demand that the negotiation open back up and that we get some of these changes that we'd like to see. When I say we, I would say labor unions actually put into the trade deal rather than just into implementation language on our side. A lot of this, I think, is about what places like Mexico are going to do in their legislatures as well. Before we can have a level of confidence that it's actually going to have the desired effect, we'd have to see that they're actually serious about passing laws in their country that are going to do things like raise wages and hold companies to higher standards. But that's just a way of introducing all of this. I'm not sure what the full timeline will look like. The administration, if they lack confidence that they're going to get a positive vote in Congress, could decide not to follow through on it. At the same time, if they think that they've got a shot at it and the president really wants it, then they'll move forward. And I think that we will see a potential vote in Congress this year. It's not getting as much coverage as the TPP did, I think, a few years back, but nevertheless, it's out there and it's coming, and it could have a pretty big impact on folks right here in Maine. So that's why we wanted to have a conversation about it tonight and hopefully hear some of your thoughts as well. So thank you all for coming.
I'm here representing workers who've lost their job from plant closures or downsizing related to foreign imports. I have lost three jobs myself for this very reason. Shoe shop closure, children's clothing manufacturer, and a woolen mill. They all became trade certified due to being affected by imports. We've experienced thousands of jobs lost here in Maine over the last 20 years. You all know that story. But because of the ability to retrain in growing industries and collect unemployment benefits while doing so, hundreds of Maine workers have moved forward successfully. The training can be up to 2 years with the potential of unemployment benefits throughout the program to help folks meet financial needs while in training. The TAA, which is the training part of the trade program, and the TRA, which is the monetary benefits part of the program, was established in 1974. In 1979, when that shoe shop closed I told you about, my mom also worked there. She was retrained as an RN and worked for the next 25 years after her graduation at their hospital in Waterville. There are hundreds of stories like this. This is just one of the success stories. There's hundreds of them. Really good training programs that people successfully completed their life's work doing. That's what's the good part of the trade program, and we don't want to lose that. I realize that we need imports and exports, but we need to make sure that any trade agreement always includes these benefits. We need this safety net for the workers who go through these events in order to help them move on successfully from that loss of income security and the loss of health insurance that always goes along with these events. This program needs to remain intact in any new agreement that comes forward. Thank you.
So Congressman Golden laid out that the new agreement that the administration has negotiated with Canada and Mexico has already been signed. But an important thing for you to know is that it's not unusual for an agreement, when it's already been signed, to actually have the negotiators come back and changes, because it doesn't become an agreement between the countries until it's ratified by all of the, you know, their versions of Congress and our version of Congress. And if our version of Congress won't vote on it, won't vote affirmatively on it, then our trade representative is going to go back and try to get the changes. And that's kind of the phase that we're at right now. The people who like the agreement and are happy with it and think it's the best thing since sliced bread are busy pounding down Congressman Golden and Congresswoman Pingree's doors and telling them to vote for it. And a lot of other people, some of you even in this room, and certainly myself and a lot of people I represent, have also been talking with our representatives about the real problems that we see. Chris has loads of experience and has been through much heartbreak with people who've lost their jobs. And that's because these agreements have been primarily negotiated to benefit the ability of companies that do business across borders to be able to maximize their profits. We want agreements that actually are designed to create good livings for people and to create to support our communities, to support workers and towns and regular people in all the countries that they impact, not just to impact the flow of capital. So some of the specific problems that we have with the new NAFTA as it's written currently, and that we hope to change so that we can get a deal that's better for our global trade, is that there are no enforcements for labor written into the agreement. There are some standards that are written in there that people are supposed to meet, but there's no meaningful enforcement. And so without that, it's just wishful thinking that any of that is going to happen. And we know that because we have a track record with not only NAFTA, but many other trade agreements that have been agreed to and signed and become sort of the rule. And when there aren't any penalties, even if there is a complaint under the agreement, which the U.S. government doesn't track for these complaints, they leave it up to organizations like ours to say they're doing it. And so if we get them to file a complaint, if the body that oversees that doesn't meet their timelines, then things can just drag on because there's no penalty for it. So some of these things don't settle until 9 years after they're filed, and meanwhile, the injustices continue. So what we're looking for in this agreement is meaningful enforcement within the agreement, enforcement that's guaranteed and that's going to happen quickly. And similarly, the congressman mentioned Mexico. I think pretty much people are familiar with the things that have happened as companies have moved jobs across the border where they can pay less and they have less restraints on them around how labor is treated. Labor unions in Mexico are essentially run by the companies in many places, which is not legal under U.S. law. It is under Mexican law. So the agreement calls for some specific changes to Mexican law to give workers more rights to stand up for themselves. But again, there's no enforcement, there's no guarantee, and even if they write the law, What we're looking for, and what so far Speaker Pelosi in Washington has stood up and said that she's looking for, is that we want to see not only the laws change it, but we want to see them beginning to implement it, actually. The agreement doesn't call for that, but we don't believe that the words in the agreement are any good until we see those laws beginning to be implemented so that there's a level playing field between the workers. Similarly, there are issues in there where the NAFTA grants great extensions of the rights of pharmacy companies to extend the patents on drugs. And I think you all know from, if you're fortunate enough to have insurance, you know that generic drugs are really different than the brand name drugs. And if it's got a patent on it, you can't have a generic for it. And NAFTA would extend that. And so even if Congress wanted to work out things to lower drug prices, it's much harder if the pharmacy companies are holding those patents for 10 years. So those are just two of the problems that are in the agreement. And mostly we want to not talk a whole lot except to have a chance for you all to ask questions and make comments. So we kind of just wanted to give you a little bit of the lay of the land. But those are some of the changes that we're looking for. Meaningful enforcement that's going to be swift and certain are the words they're using. I like those words. That's good. And we don't want to be granting longer things for pharmacy. And we want it to actually be meaningful for creating a stronger economy, not just moving capital across the borders.
So just to share a little bit more about what is in this proposed trade deal, as far as I've been able to review it in the meetings that I've had, and what you're likely to hear as this debate gets going in the country. One is the president will talk a lot about the auto industry. He's going to talk about rules of origin and where parts originate, and whether, you know, how much of any vehicle that's being made must originate in North American countries. And a lot of people are already being told that that's a big change, that it's going to protect the auto industry. When we start talking about how we go ahead and have enforcement that's verifiable and swift, I think it becomes really important. No one has been able to answer to any member of Congress in a meeting that I've been in how they intend to enforce these increased rules of origin in terms of even certifying, you know, how they would go about certifying that the parts are coming from where people are saying they are. It's great to have a rule like that, but if you don't have a process agreed to on how you're going to enforce it, then it's worth, as I sometimes say, the paper that it's written on. Beyond that, there's some really interesting other things going on. We talk about increasing the ability of workers in Mexico to unionize. Someone that isn't maybe, you know, thinking more broadly might wonder, that's great, what's that got to do with me here in Maine? I think the point is that we all know that people in Mexico work for significantly lower wages. Forget talking about benefits and other things of that nature. And therefore, there's a real incentive there for companies to outsource our jobs to Mexico. They're investing money in high-tech plants, but they're paying people pennies on the dollar to what they would pay an American worker. But more, just as importantly, what people are worth and what their labor is worth. Same with environmental standards. Companies have now moved jobs from the U.S. to Mexico, where they can dump more toxins, put people to work at lower wages, and then turn around and sell a product that used to be made in America back to the American consumer. I've talked a little bit in committee about something that is not in this trade agreement, or that this trade agreement would not allow us to do, which is talking about labeling of products. Country of origin labeling, I think, is the term. Mm-hmm. And I had an interesting interaction with a gentleman talking about American beef and packaging and where it gets manufactured. It used to be manufactured in the U.S., often now, not always, but often being manufactured outside the country now. And just if we lock into a trade deal that prohibits this, there's a movement, I think, in the United States. Certainly, I see it here in Maine, where people want to know where products are coming from. And given an option and a choice as a consumer, they'll often choose to buy local or buy American. But you don't always get that information as a consumer. And in fact, there are things in trade deals that actually prevent you from having access to that information. And so in talking with this individual about whether or not he thought that we should be pushing to make sure that trade deals would allow us as a country, as a Congress, to pass labeling laws, or to allow it, or whether or not states should be able to pass those types of laws, he kind of caught me off guard and said no. To which I said, well, geez, you know, in my experience, and I was just touring downtown Skowhegan today, we hit up, I don't know, 5, 6, 7 businesses, and a lot of them are all, their business model is based upon the idea that you all want to buy local, you know, as much as you can. I made the comment in the committee that I thought people like yourselves, within reason, within the, you know, your own budget and your own ability, will pay a little bit more for a product that was made here in Maine or in your community or in the United States. And this gentleman just swore up and down that that is not the case, that the American people want the rock bottom price. They don't care where it comes from. They want the cheapest product. And that's why pushing for something like labeling you know, capabilities was a poor use of our bargaining power. That's kind of what we're up against, just to, you know, put a, you know, give you some of the perspective of the interactions that I have down in Congress talking about trade and some of these other provisions. So the last thing I'd note on the pharmaceutical piece is we have a presidential administration that says that he wants to lower prescription medications for the American people, and a Congress, both Democrats and Republicans, that say the same. My understanding is we're getting ready in the House in May to move some bills related to trying to drive down prescription medication costs. Some of the things in this trade deal would actually tie the hands of Congress to pass those laws, particularly when dealing with monopolies. Currently, United States law for biologics, I believe, grants up to a 12-year exclusivity for a new product to market. In Canada, I think it is 8 years. Don't quote me on that, but I think that's what it is. And my understanding is that Mexico didn't really have one in the mix, and that this trade deal locks everyone into 10 across North America. I don't really see how this is to the benefit of the American consumer. We're looking at legislation that would allow people to go to Canada to buy cheaper prescription drugs. But if we're forcing them to play by the same rules of what America is dealing with right now, then I think that in the long run, that's only going to make things harder. So trade deals is about picking winners and losers to some degree. It's about showing your priorities. And in this case, I think, sadly, the people that negotiated this deal went to the table on behalf of pharmaceutical companies. Mm-hmm. It's unfortunate.
And one more question. Are there any farmers in the room? Don't see any. But another thing that was a big issue in the negotiations was price supports for dairy farmers in Canada. And it's part of why it's difficult for dairy farmers from our country to compete in the market in Canada. And so this is typical, but the solution that the agreement proposes for that problem for American farmers, U.S. farmers, excuse me, we're all three countries are American, for U.S. farmers, is to limit the Canadian government's ability to run their price support program the way they have been. And if the report that shows kind of what's going to happen if this thing passes, therefore, anticipates that we will be able to export more dairy products, at least milk. We'll get more cheese from them, but they'll get more milk from us, is what it says. Because they won't have those price supports, so they will be able to compete better. In my view, because the problem with this is that it also ties the hands of our Congress to, similarly, it will be much more difficult if our Congress were to decide, or our state, to similarly support dairy farmers. So it limits it limits not only their ability to support their dairy farmers and pulls a bit of their rug out from under them, but it also limits the options we have to support our dairy farmers. So, important difference.
Question in the back.
Yeah,